Accepted wisdom in the dating world these days is that you'll never find anyone if you're not online. People tell me not to be snobbish about it. It's different now. This is the great relationship marketplace, not the office or bars or adult education classes. This is partly a relief because I don't like bars much anyway. I can never hear anyone over the music. And I've been looking at courses I could do, but the idea of picking up Italian again when I've never got past counting to 10 is too depressing for words. But online dating feels weird. Maybe because dating always felt weird. Russell and I, well, we sort of fell in with each other. It was chance and good luck, and we laughed at the same things, and that was it. Neither of us were actively looking, but there we were. The idea of preening, presenting, being on show, I hate it. But it's the only way, they tell me. So I take a selfie on my phone after reading far too many articles about how to get a flattering angle, find a few photos that aren't too old, don't have Russell or the girls in them, and aren't too awful. And I write my profile. I'm Sophie Townsend, and this is Goodbye to All This, an original podcast from the BBC World Service. Chapter 9, Something New. Russell's ashes are still in their plastic container in the wardrobe. And once again, I've thought of the places I might scatter them, or urns I might buy, but I can't think of the right place, and all the urns look too expensive for Russell's tastes. He would hate me to be indulgent with an urn. On the second anniversary of his death, I simply leave the ashes where they are and go for a swim, take the girls out for dinner, telling them stories about their dad, which make them laugh, and then make them quiet on the drive home. The last 12 months have been so hard. A reality set in that the shock of the first year kept at bay. The grind of him not being here, the unrelenting sameness of his absence, made everything hurt. Bear's in high school now. Poppy's in her second last year of primary. They argue all the time about everything. No one can make either of them feel as bad as each other. Baiting one another, needling, it's exhausting, the way they rub up against each other. I don't know what to do about it. I don't know how to make them love each other. It's autumn and the days are getting shorter and colder. After dinner one night, as I get ready for work the next day, tidy up the kitchen, take the garbage out, I hear them getting ready for a screaming match. I turn the television on, try to concentrate on a documentary about whales and their young. The girls are upstairs, but I can feel the tension in the house rising and the yelling starts, and I look around, and what I really want now is a body next to me on the couch. I don't want to listen to this snapping and snarking. I don't want to hear crying and wailing. I don't want to be their referee. What I want is someone sitting next to me, shielding me from this, from all of it, from them and from my loneliness, and from all the things I have to do every day. I start to feel a phantom hand holding mine, a phantom arm around my shoulders. I'm aware now, listening to my children fight, the accusations and recriminations getting more hysterical, that my thoughts have moved on from them. I want something other than this. I want someone else. I go upstairs, sort out the problem. I don't even understand what the problem is, but neither do they, so it hardly matters. I soothe them both separately. Somehow, they go to bed, if not reconciled, then at least not murderous. And I think more about my reaction to their bitter yelling. Strange, really, that the sound of adolescent screaming would crystallise thoughts of romance. But it has. Maybe it's the thought of something more civilised than this. At least something more interesting. It's been coming for a while, really. The last few months. The summer. I felt a certain singularity that seemed sharper and scratchier. For the first time in a long time, I've looked at couples, felt longing. I miss him. I miss him so much. But wishing him back isn't going to work, is it? He and I had talked about this awkwardly when he was sick. You hear about those people dying, but saying to their loved one that it's okay to find someone new after they're gone. A selfless, loving act. It wasn't quite like that with Russell. He said, and I'm quoting here, "I'm not sure you'll find someone else. I mean, you're almost 40 and you've got two kids. And you're lovely and funny and a great catch, but I'm not sure you'll be able to get past all that." "Right," I'd said. "Well, thank you for that." I tried to keep it light, tried to not believe he could be this callous. I smile at him because I don't want to argue about this, not this. I tried to put it down to the morphine haze, went to get him his protein shake. When I came back, handing him the glass, he said, "I shouldn't have said that. I'm sorry." And I kissed his forehead, tried to let it go. "Well, Russell," I think, "let's see how we go at this." And lying in bed, the girls asleep, I tick off the boxes in the dating app questionnaire. Drink socially, never smoke, have children, don't want more, employed, star sign Virgo. Then I have to tick the sort of relationship I'm interested in, just for fun or serious. Neither seems to quite capture what I want, so I tick the I don't know box. I write my profile, I list my hobbies, reveal my politics, name my favourite films and books. I say that I have two children. I mention that I'm a widow. I get no takers.
"You didn't just mention that you were a widow. You actually turned it into the headline."
Lisa's right. I want it up front, not hiding down under marital status. I want them to know what they're dealing with, and then I want them to forget it. I don't want to talk about it, and I think that if I just blurt it out there in the headline, then we can just get on with it.
That's not how headlines work.
I know that the word widow is a big one, full of sadness and pity. It's old-fashioned somehow, with images of dark black veils and shawls, heavy grim clouds. But Lisa's right when she points out the problem with my headline. Widow in inner West Sydney wears a lot of black, but not because I'm sad all the time. And I revise it. On the app I use, it's called a kiss when someone takes an interest. And after rewriting the headline, I get some. Like some sort of teenage girl waiting for the boys to notice her, I check to see the kisses more often than I think is dignified. The girls ask me why, when my phone dings, I get so anxious, why I check it so often. I tell them it's work, a big project at work. I don't want them to know yet that I'm looking for someone. I don't want them to get confused or hurt or feel unsafe. I try to relax about the kisses, at least in front of them. I check my phone only after they're in bed and I'm alone. And then I reject almost every man who shows me any interest. I don't like their politics. I don't like their hobbies. They live too far away or too close. I don't like their profile, the way they use too many exclamation marks or too many cliches or put their apostrophes in the wrong places. Men who own cats get short shrift. Men with no pets at all are dismissed. Men with children younger than mine, men who have no children at all, none of them are right. Lisa says that my standards are too high.
What about that man with the tropical fish? He was lovely.
I tell her that those standards got me Russell and that they're fine. I have two children after all. I can't hook up with the first guy who fancies me. To shut her up, I accept one date with a man who takes my suggestion to meet at a wine and cheese bar. As I'm looking at the selection of wine and cheeses, he tells me he's allergic to dairy. I ask him why he said yes to this bar, and he looks embarrassed as he shrugs his shoulders. We're at an impasse now, and all I can think to talk about is how much my dead husband loved cheese, which I do for the rest of the evening. He orders a bowl of mixed nuts. We don't meet again. But when I get home, Bear asks where I've been. I tell her a work thing and she says, "Did you go out on a date?" And I ask her how she knows. And she rolls her eyes and says that firstly, I have too much perfume on. And secondly, she saw the app on my phone a couple of weeks ago. I ask her how she feels about this, and she shrugs, in the way teenagers do. I ask her if Poppy knows. She's the one who showed me the app. Poppy's in bed, and I go into her room and lie with her. I don't mean to wake her, but she says sleepily that when Daddy used to lie with her, he let her stroke his earlobe, and she wishes I had bigger earlobes. I never find the right time to talk to Poppy about the dating app. I wish I could, and I wish I knew what to say, but I let it lie between us. And then Lisa takes me out to see a band. And I'm waiting at the bar to get us a drink. And the man next to me, waiting for his beer, tells me he likes my shoes. And I choose him. That's all it takes in the end. Just someone noticing something and smiling politely. It's all I want. It's glorious. For 6 weeks, it's glorious. When he texts, I reply only after I've drafted several witty responses and checked for spelling and grammar obsessively. My skin tingles when I see him. When I don't see him, I'm waiting for his call. He has become exactly what I wanted. The phantom hand, the phantom arm, there in the flesh. I don't care so much about the girls' squabbles. I don't care so much about cooking dinner every night or helping them with their homework. I don't care so much about putting out the garbage, getting the car serviced, because I can see an end to it all. I have him now, and it will get better. It will. This loneliness is gone. The drudgery is gone. I tell the girls that I've met someone. I sit them down and explain that no one will replace their father, but that I want to be happy and this man makes me happy. They're embarrassed. I'm embarrassed. There's an awful lot of shrugging. He asks me what their reaction was to the idea of him, and I say they're very excited to meet him. And it's funny because by the time I tell him this, I believe it. They'll love him, I'm sure of it. I want him to meet my girls and have dinner with us and have him help them with their homework. I want him to cook with me and share wine over risotto and make the girls laugh with his silly jokes. He'll put out the garbage. He will. I love you, I say. And he winces. I tried to take it back, of course, say it was just the heat of the moment. But we both know I feel something he doesn't. We tried to get back on an even keel, give it a week or two, but he takes longer to return calls and I call more often, and the night comes where we go out to a bar and end up in an argument, and he says he'll call the next day, and he doesn't, and it's over. It's almost spring. The man who liked my shoes but didn't love me had kept me going through the winter. The new season, with its warmer days and colour and smells, feels to me like a personal affront. I want to be back in his bed, cuddling up against the cold. All that the spring means now is that it's 2.5 years that I've been a widow. And it feels extra hard walking in the spring wind this year because I tried for something new and failed. I wanted something else and messed it up. I keep looking for the kisses on the dating app. My phone beeps at their arrival, but eventually I turn the notifications off, checking only occasionally, when I'm bored or can't sleep. You've got to work at the app. You've got to put new photos up, connect with other people. I let my presence on the site sit there, getting outdated. The kisses come less frequently, and eventually I take my profile off the dating app entirely. I paid a year's subscription and I tell myself that in a couple of months I'll get back to it, but I don't. You're not supposed to give up this easily. You've got to keep going, because otherwise you'll never find anyone, ever. This is what people tell me. And I tell them I know, but I realised that the girls aren't quite old enough or quite over the death of their father enough. And in that 6 weeks, I'd neglected them a bit and I've learnt my lesson now.
It wasn't really about the girls, though.
It was her pride. It was a knock to my confidence. It was that awful thing of thinking you're tough enough and realising you're not. It was also that clarity that Russell had, that I wouldn't find anyone new. God, how I wished in that moment he'd been more selfless, more ready to let me go. It's an awful thing to have rattling round in your head, and it makes me so angry that he could be so careless.
I don't think it's actually what Russell said. I think it's more like when you have a bruise, and even if you press it gently, it still hurts.
That bruise of being alone and missing him and all the rest. And it's hard, that bruise, because you want it gone, you really do, but you don't know how to relieve it, and it lingers, no matter what you do. On a cold, miserable day, the sort of spring day where Sydney seems to forget what season it is and plunges us back into winter temperatures, I forced the girls out of the house to come for a walk. They're quite happy inside, looking at their phones, and they whine and whinge, but finally come. And while we're walking, they don't argue with each other, too busy complaining about the wind and my insistence on walking on such a cold day. They found a common enemy. I reach for Poppy's hand, but she refuses. Bear remains sullen too. And I tell them, okay, I get it, they can go home. I resist saying that their father would be disappointed in them, partly because he wouldn't be on a cold winter's day with the decision to stay indoors, and partly because their father's disappointment feels way too unfair to burden them with. They look at each other with relief, pleased that their sulking has paid off this time. I give them the house key, tell them I'll walk on a little, alone. I want something else. I really do. I wish I was ready, that it didn't hurt so much. I wish I wasn't afraid, and I wish I wasn't so lonely. I wish I didn't miss him like I do. I look at them heading back to the house, and I wonder how much longer this goes on. This hurt. That day, when I brought Russell his protein shake, after he'd apologised, he said, I guess I can't imagine you finding someone else, because it really means that I won't be here. I'll be gone. And I can't figure that. I really can't. I can't figure it either. And as I walk back to the house alone and cold, I wonder, when does this life feel as if it's real? When does it feel like it's yours? And when do you feel like you can get through it without him? When does this bruise disappear? How many weeks, months, years before it fades?
Frozen lake,
Goodbye to All This is produced by me, Sophie Townsend, and Eleanor McDowell. The music has been specially created for the podcast by Jeremy Wormsley. Alan Hall is the executive producer. The consultant story editor from CBC Podcasts is Chris Oak. The BBC World Service podcast editor is John Minnell. It's a Falling Tree production for the BBC World Service.